consists of two separate machines. The long part is what we would call a prime mover. This is the actual steam engine. The sole purpose of this part of the machine is to turn the shaft. At the other end, we have the actual generator. So one unit is supplying the power to rotate the part in the generator. This is a one-cylinder steam engine. It's a comparatively small one. I've seen some of the private power plants years ago where one engine would almost fill our entire engine room. So these were really quite small by the standards of today. Another good example are the steam engines that used to supply water to cities, municipal waterworks pumping engines, and there are a number of them still in existence. They're not running, but they simply never bothered to scrap them. They left them sitting in the station. These engines stand 5 stories high. So steam engines were monstrous or little, depending on the various applications. Now, as it speeds up, you'll hear a banging sound from the flywheel, which is normal. This is simply the governor starting to take control. A steam engine always ran at the same speed, and there's a governor in the flywheel that controls that. So when I bring this engine up to speed, it's running at about 260-70 revolutions a minute. If I were to put the building load on the engine, which I can't do anymore, the engine speed would not noticeably change, because as the load increased, the governor would sense that the engine was starting to slow down and let more steam in. The governor, which is this thing in the flywheel, this will shift position as the engine comes up to speed. Centrifugal force on this part overcomes the tension on the spring. This is also the mechanism that controls the steam going in and out of the cylinder. Inside the housing is a valve that slides back and forth and lets the steam alternately in and out of the cylinder. In the cylinder, there is a piston. It's about 3 inches thick. It's the same diameter as the cylinder, and the steam going in and out of the cylinder pushes that back and forth. So what you have is a piston in here being pushed back and forth by steam, and this mechanism simply converts the reciprocating motion to the rotary motion necessary for the generator.
Now, they can predict pretty well by past experience, but still,
they can't just say, oh, we're not going to run at full power, we're going to take it easy today. We can't do that. We have the same problem with heat. We cannot control demand for heat. We could cut back on a building, we could shut down a building, but under normal circumstances, and again, by experience, we know on a given temperature day, approximately what our load is going to be. We have three boilers, so we may run one, two, or three, and again, that's part of the engineer's job to anticipate what he's going to need to carry the load under whatever the conditions are. So in a sense, we have to sort of get, the weather may suddenly turn warm and we find we don't need two boilers. We're shutting them down. It may go the other way. All of a sudden, by mid-afternoon, it may drop as it does in November, December, and you'll start to see problems with the steam pressure, then you have to start more boilers. So we're constantly turning things on and off, again, to meet the load. I'll only come upstairs so I don't have to yell. Now these engines are what are called reciprocating steam engines simply because the parts move back and forth and reciprocate. The next generation of machinery, and that's what you'll find today in any big utility plant, is called the steam turbine. And we have one of those sitting over there, no longer in use, but you'll notice it looks completely different. That casing that has a blue covering over it is a highly sophisticated windmill. There is a big steel rotor inside that casing with thousands of tiny blades on it. The blades may be about as big as a finger, and they're all at a slight angle. And the steam is allowed to blow into the end of the turbine, and as it hits all these little vanes, it causes the shaft to rotate. And it goes through the turbine, hitting one row of blading after another until it eventually comes out. But the motion on the turbine is directly rotary, whereas this has to be converted from reciprocating to rotary. The turbines are much more efficient than the steam engines, especially in large sizes. So any of your big utility plants today will have a turbine again. It's all a matter of scale. A plant like Conrad Ravenswood will have a turbine twice the size of its engine room. But again, you're talking hundreds of thousands of kilowatts. Our poor little machines are only 100 horsepower. Now, anybody have any questions as we're going along here, you know, yell out.